Thank you, Samira, for that very generous introduction, and thanks to all of you for being here on a day when you could be lolling about on the grass in the sun. I'm going to talk to you today on a theme concerning which I've reflected for quite a number of years, and to which I'm just coming back, and in a slightly different manner to the one which I've treated it in the past. A good place to begin reflecting on this theme, which is before Orientalism, and the question of the West and the East, Europe, and in particular India, in the early modern period, is a place to which South Asian historians all too often don't go, which is the graveyard. This is a rather interesting, quite spectacular graveyard, which I'll recommend to all those of you who happen to want to visit the Taj Mahal. This is the Christian cemetery in Agra. And it is a cemetery which dates to the second half of the 16th century. And it contains a very large number of Christian tombs, both those of some of the Christian grandees of the Mughal Empire, of which there were a certain number, famously the Armenian Mirza Zulkarnain, who was a great patron of the Jesuits when they first entered the Mughal court. But you also find here the first grave of an Englishman in India, I believe. This is John Mildenhall, who died in about 1610 or 11. This is also where you find some of the earliest Italian graves in India, of people like the Maffeis and others who served as surgeons and doctors in the Mughal court at the time of the emperors Jahangir and Shah Jahan. Now, this graveyard, which is located, as you can see over here, roughly, so this is the Taj Mahal over here, this is the fort, and that is the graveyard on the road to Sikandra, which is the tomb of the Mughal Emperor Akbar. So this is a very interesting place to actually begin to reflect on the whole question of Western visitors to the Mughal Empire, what they were doing, what sort of variety of different perspectives they embodied, and also the kinds of reflections which they brought to this great polity, which was seen, after all, in about 1600 as one of these three great Islamic monsters, which is to say what we used to be referred to customarily at that time as the Great Turk, which is to say the Ottoman, the Great Sufi, or the Great Sufi, which is to say the Safavid rulers of Iran, and the Great Mughal, which is to say the dynasty which had been set up by Zahiruddin Muhammad Babur in the 1520s in this part of the world. Now, the kinds of people whom I'm going to be referring to today are people who might well have been buried in this graveyard. Some of them, as it happens, were buried somewhat further east. But what we are actually going to see is a kind of a conversation for which this graveyard is a starting point, also because one little part of my reflection is actually going to be on the relationship between Western Christians and Armenians in the context of the Mughal Empire. Now, the typical Western visitor to India in the 17th century or the later 16th century normally came at it through one of two routes. So you either entered India from the ports, that is to say, from places such as Goa over here, or Machilipatnam over here, or Hooghly over here. This is the typical route that was taken by the bulk of your Portuguese visitors, your Dutch visitors, your English visitors. So there's that point of entry from the periphery, so to speak, into the centers of the great land-bound political formations. But there's also another route, which is the older route, the traditional route, the one that brings one through Iran, through Kabul and Kandahar, into Lahore, and eventually into northern India, which is typically the route which is taken by a different kind of traveler. It's often the route which is taken by the Italians. It's often the route which is taken by the French, and in particular, it's taken by those who, of course, come to India from the Ottoman and the Iranian world, of which there's a certain number whom I shall be returning to from time to time. So there are, in some senses, two kinds of Europeans who come to India in the 17th century. There are those who come to India, in some senses, with a disconnect, and who actually have made this maritime voyage from Europe without necessarily having a great deal of intervening experience. And then there are those who are actually coming to India with a prior experience of the Islamic world, and a prior experience of the Islamic world which is going to take them naturally very often to considering the Mughal Empire in relation to Iran in relation to the Ottomans, and sometimes also in relation to Central Asia. So this is something which one needs to bear in mind, which is, in the case of the latter, we're actually dealing with a kind of a prior framing, and it's a prior framing which is going to lend itself, of course, to certain kinds of generalizations which will emerge concerning the Orient. Now, of course, when one thinks about the Orient, there's no escaping this book. Published in 1978, now in its 23 years after its original publication, perhaps the most cited work concerning Orientalism by some measure. We cannot even begin to compare the number of citations of this book, say, to Raymond Schwab's La Renaissance Orientale. But this is a book which is, of course, as you very well know, an extremely controversial book. And one part of the controversy, to which I'll return presently, is the fact that when the book was published, and in the decade immediately after its publications, many people who thought of themselves as Orientalists, and there were indeed people who were not ashamed to say in the 1980s even that they were Orientalists, it's something which is easily forgotten. So what we're actually dealing with is a situation in which people, for example, who might have published in journals such as the Journal Asiatique, I believe there are even some people in this room who have published in the Journal Asiatique, or the ZDMG, the Zeitschrift der Deutschen Mughaländischen Gesellschaft. So such people, in fact, often complained on reading Said's book, Orientalism, that they didn't recognize themselves in it. Right? That it was really not about them. It was about something else. And there was a certain sense in which there had been a kind of a misrecognition, a finger pointing in a direction where nobody was seated. Right? And there was therefore a feeling that in some senses there was a real problem here of confounding very, very different things and calling them by a single name or a single title. I remember myself attending a meeting of the Société Asiatique sometime in the late 1980s, which was devoted very largely to this question, and where the bulk of the Orientalists in the room pointed out that even though some of the great French Orientalists who were cited in Said's book, such as Sylvestre de Sacy or even Sylvain Lévy, were mentioned and sometimes accused of various forms of misreading and so on, that actually Said had not taken on board their central writings. In fact, he was often addressing their marginal writings, and that he had actually not systematically, for instance, studied the archives of any of these great institutions. Now, of course, it is interesting that when you go back to read Said himself, very early in the book, he actually does very clearly state that there is a problem. Right? And he tells us that the problem is that there are two kinds of Orientalism. Right? This is already on page 2 of his book, where he tells us that there is, first of all, an academic definition of Orientalism, right? Which is a label which still serves, as he says, in a number of academic institutions. Anyone who teaches, writes about, or researches the Orient, and this applies whether the person is an anthropologist, sociologist, historian, or philologist, either in its specific or its general aspects, is an Orientalist, and what he or she does is Orientalism. So that's one definition. And then he tells us there's another quite different definition, and this is really where the problem arises, which is, he says, there's a very large mass of writers, amongst whom are poets, novelists, philosophers, political theorists, economists, and imperial administrators who have accepted the basic distinction between East and West as the starting point for elaborate theories and so on. For him, this too is Orientalism. Right. So this means that not only is Sylvestre de Sacy or Anquetil du Perron an Orientalist, but Lord Curzon is an Orientalist too. Not only is the T.E. Lawrence of the Seven Pillars of Wisdom an Orientalist, the T.E. Lawrence who actually sat in conferences and made decisions about making boundaries in the Middle East, he's also an Orientalist. So there's a kind of a interesting sense of confounding what are people, for instance, painters who paint the exotic scenes of the East and scholars who actually think of themselves as seriously studying the East in a kind of a dedicated and continuous fashion. Now, this is a problem which continues to dog the debate around Orientalism in the post-Sayyidian world. And I just want to refer very quickly to a set of recent contributions which continue to go round and round the subject in one fashion or the other. So, for example, a recent book by Nicholas Dew that you see on the left here, Orientalism in Louis XIV's France, essentially focuses on the emergence of a certain kind of academic institutional structure for the study of the Orient. Right? So this is actually not concerned, let's say, with people who are painting scenes, exotic scenes of the Ottoman Empire or of the harem somewhere or the other. This is not his concern. He's actually trying to give you a genealogy of the academic study of the Orient as it emerged as a subject. So it's the first of Said's two Orientalisms that he's trying to study over here. And he's actually trying to tell you, or that's one of Dew's claims at any rate, that this is something which begins in the 17th century. So in fact, he's also trying to set a kind of a terminus to the matter. So he clearly does not want to claim that, say, we can recover Herodotus into Orientalism. So there's an idea that Orientalism has a beginning, and this beginning is an early modern beginning, and it is a beginning which has to do essentially with the 17th century, though ironically in a situation in which Dew is not particularly concerned to look at some of the imperial institutions or neo-imperial institutions, to which I'll return, such as the East India Company, the French East India Company, which was also founded at the time of Louis XIV. But he is nevertheless interested in looking at this. And the person whom he focuses on to a considerable extent is the subject, of course, of this second book, an extremely important figure, someone who has been referred to many, many times in a variety of literature, which is the French physician and traveler, François Berryer, who studied at Montpellier, who was very close to Pierre Gassendi, who came to India in the 1650s and reported on India to a variety of interlocutors in Europe, some of whom are political figures to whom I will return, but who clearly was someone who considered himself to be a serious student of India, who learned a certain amount of Persian, we don't know exactly how much, who actually spent a good part of his time in India also translating works from Latin and Greek into Persian for the use of grandees in the Mughal Empire, so also who was serving as a kind of a two-way conduit, and who, of course, is extremely important in terms of his later history, because Bernier is one of the central sources used by Montesquieu, and of course, from Montesquieu, he passes through eventually to Marx. So in some senses, the core, in many respects, of Marx's Asiatic mode of production can be derived from the narrative in Bernier. Right? So this is something which we can actually see moving forward into a very important 19th and even 20th century representations. Of course, you do then have a more recent work which provides you with a slightly different take on matters, which is Susan Machon's recent book on German Orientalism in the Age of Empire, where she is more concerned with the idea of a kind of high Orientalism emerging in the later period, that is to say, typically in the 19th century. But again, she's very careful to distance herself from Said, and she wants to actually make the point that if you want to study Orientalism, it is not good enough to actually take that larger definition, which is to say where all kinds of people from Flaubert writing Salammbô to whoever can be included inside the category of Orientalists. You actually have to look at the great Orientalist institutions, which is to say you actually have to look at the construction of this in a sense of an institutional history. So, of course, her approach remains largely biographical. Now, just to sort of very quickly complete the picture, we do have a kind of a hesitation still present, though, if you look at the more recent literature. This most recent book, it's about 2.5 years old now, edited by my former colleague François Pouillon, which is on which is a kind of an encyclopedia des Orientalistes de langue française. So it's a bit different in the sense that it's about people who write in French. So these could be Belgians, of course, but they could also be, for instance, quote-unquote, Orientals themselves. Right? So, so long as they write in French, he considers them to be Orientalists. And what Pouillon actually includes over here is a very diverse set of people. So he tends, in contradistinction to those whom we have looked at before, to have the larger, more inclusive version of Said's definition in mind. So anyone who paints any kind of scene, for instance, or anyone who even vaguely travels or who writes, or, I mean, even someone like, let's say, the very peculiar Franco-Swiss writer, Blaise Sondrars, who actually wrote this very strange book called Bourlanguer, which is a kind of an account of the brothels of the East, amongst other things. So this too is Orientalism, in some sense, in Pouillon's definition, as distinct from the more rigorous kind of definition which these other authors are writing. Now, what I'm going to do today is actually to move back, in some sense, to the more rigorous definition. And what I want to go back and look at is the whole question of, in some sense, the challenge which is set out for us by Dew, which is to say, to look at the possibility that something actually happened in the 17th century in terms of the emergence of a new kind of a new kind of gaze, which was then institutionalized. I'm going to try and link it to the emergence of new institutions in the 17th century. And I'm going to also argue that in order to understand this, we need to look at various competing accounts of the Orient, and in particular, in my instance, India, which emerged in the 17th century. So therefore, to look at the diversity of this field and the kinds of tensions that are the result of this diversity. I could have chosen many points of departure for this. I could have chosen someone like this, for instance, this notorious swindler and scoundrel of the early 17th century, the Englishman Anthony Shirley, who traveled very extensively, who, as you can see, traveled not merely east but west, who was a close friend of Walter Raleigh's, who eventually visited Iran, was at the Safavid court briefly, was constantly forging papers of and letters of credentials for himself, and who eventually wound up in the last 20 years of his life of all places, in Granada, in southern Spain, writing advice for the Habsburg monarchs on how to deal with the world at large. Right? Shirley has sometimes been described as the Henry Kissinger of the 17th century. Whether this is a compliment to either Shirley or Kissinger is presently unclear. Now, so what I want to actually do from here forward is to actually focus on one single narrative, one incredibly important person who has also been somewhat forgotten and neglected. And I want to actually use this as my close example in order to show you, in some senses, how the 17th century Orientalism, in some senses, emerged, what its institutional conditions were, but also I will then try to set this person in a context or in relation to a set of tensions that existed at this time. The person I'm going to talk about is this person. His name is François Le Gouze de La Boulaye, or sometimes called La Boulaye Le Gouze, who was from Anjou, and who was a traveler who visited a very, very large part of the world. This is the extent of his travels. So this is someone who traveled extensively in Italy, in Ireland, in Denmark, in the Baltic, through the Ottoman Empire in Egypt, but also extensively through Iran and eventually in India, who wound up, who died in the late 1660s in Patna, in Azimabad, the Mughal provincial capital of a part of eastern India, who was extremely influential in his time, and I'll come back to why he was influential and also why he came to be forgotten somewhat. But this is someone who allows us to do a series of different things. Okay. So bear in mind that this is someone who has also who published an account of a part of his travels. This was an account which was published in 1653 and published in 1657. This is the 1657 edition that you have here. And if you actually look at this, you can see the modest size of his travels. He says, "Gouvernement et situation des États et Royaumes d'Italie, Grèce, Anatolie, hein, Syrie, Perse, Palestine, Karamanik, Chaldée, hein, Assyrie, Grand Mongol, Bijapur, Indes orientales des Portugais, Arabie, Égypte, Hollande, Grande-Bretagne, Irlande, Denmark, Pologne, so on and so forth." Right? So that you have a very, very large number of places. Now, this is an account which allows us something which immediately, which is this is not someone who's just traveling to the East. So it actually allows us a kind of normalization, because what we're able to do here is to have a traveler who travels both east and west, as it were. So we can actually see whether the techniques and the perspectives which he brings, for instance, to a description of, let's say, Denmark or Ireland. Actually, he travels to Ireland at the time of the English Civil War. Are they, in fact, fundamentally different from the ways in which he addresses, let's say, the Ottoman Empire or the Mughals? Is it in fact the case that we can see that there is a distinct perspective when his eye is turned to the Orient or not? So this is one thing which he allows us to do. But the second thing which he allows us to do is he actually allows us to see how someone like him functions because of the fact, which is a very peculiar fact, which I'm going to come to in a moment. If we actually go back to people like Betty, or we go back to a large number of the most influential and published travelers of the 17th century, a peculiar thing about them is that publication has a kind of a screening effect. There are practically no manuscripts left of Bernier's travel account. Right? So all we have are the published accounts. The same is true of someone else to whom I will come back presently, Jean-Baptiste Tavernier, the jeweler and traveler. Again, we have no manuscripts left of his account. All we have is the final published product. And this is very problematic in Tavernier's case because we know that actually the bulk of the account was not written by him. It was actually written by a man called Samuel Chapuzot, who was someone whom he employed to do his writing. So we in fact don't exactly know what the relationship finally is between author and published text. The great advantage with Legouze de la Boulaye, as we'll see presently, is that we can actually follow him from manuscript through to publication. And we can actually see certain very interesting effects that then happen in the process of the transformation between manuscript and published artifact. Okay, now, there is, as I said, a very small bibliography on him because he's been largely forgotten. These are three of the items. The second is a peculiar sort of false re-edition because all it is excerpts taken out of the text published by Monsieur de Favier in 1994. The last account is the most important because this is the identification of the manuscript, which actually helps us in a part of the process. And then there is this very curious article in the Gazette des Beaux-Arts, which talks about how one of the effects of his travels was, briefly at least, to bring a kind of a false Persian fashion into Louis XIV's court. So it had some sort of effect in terms of clothing and costume as it was practiced for a certain time at least. So this is how Legouze de la Boulaye then presents himself at the outset of his narrative. So what does it say here? It says, Portrait du Sieur de la Boulaye Legouze, habit levantin, connu en Asie et Afrique sous le nom de Ibrahim Beg. Et en Europe, sous celui de voyageur catholique. Very interesting contrast over here. So we have, first of all, an affirmation that he's a Catholic, and of course this is quite important when he, in the Irish part of his travels. But he also wants us to understand that he was one of those people who characteristically also disguised himself and called himself by another name, of course a strategy which will be repeated time and again. Most famously by Burton, and then of course by T.E. Lawrence as well. So we have this notion over here. We have him then with a celestial and a terrestrial globe flanking him in some sense, and we have a notion then of the extent of his voyages. Now, as he presents himself, Legouze de la Boulaye was interested fundamentally in ethnography. He was interested in a much more minor way in questions of economics, economic products, and so on and so forth. He often does talk about this, but fundamentally his whole idea is that the organizing principle of his travels is ethnographic observation. And ethnographic observation which fundamentally follows from the production of what he thinks of as creative stereotypes. Right? So he has this idea that fundamentally all peoples in the world can be classified, and once they are classified, you can actually do interesting and creative exercises with the classification. So the first exercise which he's interested in and which he repeats throughout the whole text is what he calls the problem of sympathy and antipathy. So there's the whole idea that if you can take peoples in the world, you can go on pairing them on the question of whether they are sympathetic to one another or whether they are antipathic to one another. On what grounds? He says, well, three grounds, la nature, their very nature, les lois, et la police. So the laws and la police here is, I suppose, best translated as something like civility. It's in that sense that it's being used. So he says, in general, what he's trying to try to actually show us is the readers is that when you travel from one place to another, you can classify people, and you can come to as he says, reflections on their complexions and temperaments, and you can actually get to some sort of sense like this. And he actually has this very curious observation on this moment when he says that, in fact, in many respects, humans and monkeys are not very different, and that when he was on his travels, for instance, there was a moment in India where he found black monkeys and white monkeys, and he actually observed them together, and he came to the conclusion that actually these singes noirs et singes blancs, these black monkeys and white monkeys, could be classified in terms of their antipathy, for instance, in a very similar way to, and let me give you a set of his pairings, right? So these are the antipathic pairings. Polonais et Allemands, right? So Poles and Germans, they have a basic antipathy according to him. And this is exactly like Écossais et Anglais, Scots and English, Français et Espagnol, French and Spaniards, Portugais et Maure, so Portuguese, and here Muslims, interestingly, right? Arab et Abyssin, Arabs and Abyssinians, Chinois et Japonais, Chinese and Japanese, Tartare et Moscovite, Tartars and Muscovites, Grec et Italien. So these are, according to him, equivalent pairings on the basis of which you can actually go about matters. Now, of course, what you can see over here is directly that there is no particular privilege being given here to Oriental and Occidental as fundamental differences. In fact, the same types of schema, according to him, can be generalized and can be made use of irrespective of whether one is West or East, whether one is in Denmark, or whether one is in Ireland, or whether one is in the Ottoman Empire. In some senses, similar principles can be deployed for the ethnographic voyager. At a certain moment, he even starts to develop more complex structural schema. So, for example, he has these triangulations of what he calls les ennemis antipathiques et les ennemis sympathiques. So then you get triangulations. I'll give you just one example of triangulation. Ottoman, Arab, Persan. So Ottomans, Arabs, Persians are equivalent to Spaniards, Italians, French. Right? So what the Ottomans are to the Arabs, the Spaniards are to the Italians. What the Arabs are to the Persians, the Italians are to the French. In some senses, this means that the Persians and the French can be thought of as fairly similar, and the Arabs and the Italians can be thought of as fairly similar, and the Ottomans and the Spaniards can be thought of as fairly similar, right? And this is, of course, something which has been developed elsewhere by one of my students, who's made the argument that, in fact, your typical 17th century traveler is often much more sympathetic to Iranians and to Persia than to the Ottoman Empire. Right? Because they actually see elements, and especially this is true of French travelers, tend to see elements of themselves in the Persians, whereas they tend to see elements of other Europeans whom they do not like in the Ottomans. So what we have here then is a kind of construction which is, as I said, not disposed in the first instance to distinguish between Orient and Occident as a fundamental binary. It's actually disposed to do quite other things. It's disposed, of course, also to fairly rudimentary geographical description and so on and so forth, also some economic description. And incidentally, one of the big questions which was often debated was the quality of the illustrations in his account. So these are some of the illustrations which you find. This is Amasya. This is the what he calls the Sarai. And this here, for example, are other drawings that he has. This is supposed to be the daughter of the great Mughal. You have, for example, this text, which some people have used in order to sort of pull him in the direction of the kind of the lustful Occidental, which is to say, here he's supposedly talking about a erotic scene between a Mughal and what he calls in Mughalier, which is a kind of very strange Italo-French construction using Molière and Mughal. And what he has is this female slave who's looking away in embarrassment at this sort of erotic embrace between the two of them, apparently. Okay. Now, he does indeed have, once in a while, something which may be seen as titillating, such as this drawing of a woman in India. Now, here's where getting the manuscript begins to help us. Because if we had remained with these visual representations, very crude, very poor, in fact, which would be superseded very quickly within a generation or so by the Dutch engravers who were working for Tavernier and who were working for the other travelers of the, let's say, the 1680s forward, you would actually have this notion that these were very primitive drawings, perhaps made by Boulez-Legouze himself. But when we get to the manuscript, we see something which is extremely interesting, which is you realize that, in fact, the manuscript actually has a very curious participation of Indian artists in it, right? So what he's actually done is, if you look through the manuscript, he has actually written text and left spaces where Indian artists, in fact, there are clearly two sets of Indian artists, have made drawings for him. So, for example, this is an account of a Rajput, a cavalier Rajput, as he says, servant le roi de Bijapur, ou le grand Mughal. So you have this, it's a very characteristic Western Indian drawing. Right? This almost certainly comes from either Gujarat or the part of Western India, the Western Deccan. In fact, it also has these elements in it which are very characteristic of certain kinds of drawings from this period, which is to say these little clumps of grass or vegetation which punctuate the drawing. So as I said, he has different artists participating. He has certainly two sets of Indian artists participating. He also has some European artists, and he also has himself. He's the worst. He has the worst hand, as we'll see presently. So this is, for example, the frontispiece of the manuscript, where he shows us himself presenting the manuscript to the patron, to whom I'm going to come in a minute or two. So what we have then is something which is starting to emerge, at least in my mind, as a more complex object. It is an object which he is not producing himself. He is, in some senses, to fall back on the history of science kind of vocabulary, he's co-producing. He's providing some of the framing for it, but there's another set of voices over here. There's another set of agencies over here in the production of the material itself. Okay? So now here, for example, is his own drawing. You can see he doesn't have a great hand. Right? So this is his account of his drawing of a Kazalbash of the Shia followers of the Turkoman Shia followers of the Safavids, and you can see here how this has become this in the engraver's version, right? So in some sense here the engraver has done some work of improvement, though he's probably confounded the Kazalbash head with some kind of a Native American head. Now, but on the other hand, you have materials like this, because one of the things that Legouze de la Boulay is actually probably not sufficiently credited for is that he's the person who actually, of the travelers, who gives one of the relatively early, not the first, but a relatively early account of what we would today call popular Hinduism. That is to say, not the high textual Hinduism of the Sanskrit texts, but popular Hinduism such as it was practiced in Western India where he had been. Okay? Now this is meant to be, this is meant to show you a series of gods. So the god that you have on top, many of you will recognize, is Krishna, surrounded by his devotees. Here you have, again, Krishna. This is the scene where Krishna has stolen the clothes of his female followers. Now, but this is very interesting. This is actually a figure, relatively minor figure, who's Shravan Kumar, who is a figure who appears in stories in the larger cycle of texts associated with the Ramayana. Okay? And what you have with Legouze de la Boulay is that he provides you actually a kind of basic narrative of these, but he also has these illustrations. Now, here's where it becomes interesting when we look at this in comparison to the manuscript, right? Now, this is the manuscript version, and here, again, very clearly, these are Indian artists who produced this for him. And in fact, what has happened, in a sense, which is in the opposite direction to where we were with regard to the other illustration, where the relatively crude materials of Legouze de Boulay have been improved by the engraver, is in some senses that these have been considerably impoverished in the process of the transition from manuscript to printed text. Right? This is a much more elaborate and much more convincing Krishna that you see over here than the one that you see that you see over here, though many of the elements are indeed the basic elements are retained. Okay? So in some sense, what we're dealing with here is, as I said, a co-production. This is someone who then is not doing what, Orientalists are typically accused of, which is simply a straightforward imposition of their categories or their materials on a relatively passive object, which is the Orient. This is really a much more conversational affair. Which again you see over here, and again you see over here, for example, you can see how these relatively nice drawings, again produced in Western India by a set of artists for him, have been, of course, used, but somewhat transformed in the printed version. Okay. If we follow the rest of the illustrations, we can develop this point. I don't want to take you too far in that direction, but what I want you to bear in mind then is, so this is, for example, again, this is Laguz de la Boulaye's hand. This is how he draws, and this is what the engraver has been able to make of it. So what we're actually dealing with over here is someone who is extremely, creative, capable of absorbing materials, capable of working with them, has a very vast curiosity. For example, not only do we have these Indian stories here, for instance, is the story of Layli and Majnu from the Persian tradition, which he's also drawn upon. And this is someone who, though he, as I said, thinks of himself as a Catholic, is still working within a framework where he considers himself, in some senses, not fetishizing or pushing the notion of a kind of an Orient which separates the world east of the Ottoman Empire from the world to the west of the Ottoman Empire. We can also see, incidentally, that from time to time there's a very serious misunderstanding which takes place between his manuscript and the printed version. Here, in the printed version, somehow this becomes a representation of a Parsi, which, of course, it has nothing to do with a Parsi. We used to say a Zoroastrian. Okay, now, what actually is the impact of this text? The impact of this text is very significant for a short period. 1653, the first edition is published. 1657, the second edition is published. All of a sudden, Laguz de la Boulaye becomes, in some senses, the great specialist on these matters. And curiously, he then is taken on board. I'll very quickly run through a few of these illustrations. I want to come back to this. He's taken on board as someone who has a great deal of knowledge, who is seen not merely as a traveler, but someone who has pretensions to being an antiquarian, who actually, in the course of his travels, has actually looked at the traces left behind by the ancients. So here he claims to have visited and copied what was actually written on the belt of a mummy. And we also get, as you can see, accounts of his visits to the Sphinx and to the pyramids in Egypt. So this is someone who is seen as a great erudite figure, who has some degree of philological expertise, who has some degree of knowledge, as I said, based upon a kind of an antiquarian conception of things, but who also has a lot of practical knowledge and also this kind of ethnographic savoir-faire, which allows him to look at the world. So how does this eventually translate in practical terms? Where it translates in practical terms is in 1663-64, when Jean-Baptiste Colbert, the minister of Louis XIV, is looking to set up an East India Company. So he actually needs someone who is going to advise him on the manner in which this East India Company should be set up. Now, Colbert actually had a very interesting set of advisors and people who informed him. What has, in fact, not been perhaps adequately taken into consideration in the literature is the extent to which Colbert not only depended on people like Bernier, which he certainly did, but the extent to which he actually had a very curious mix of three kinds of people who he used. He used, first of all, these relatively secular travelers like Bernier, but especially Laguz de la Boulaye. He also used and had a very interesting relationship with a set of Huguenots. especially from the northern part of France, and some of whom had worked earlier for the Dutch East India Company. And the third set of people whom he used and who were his principal informants in the first stages of setting up the company were the Armenians. So it's a combination of Armenian Huguenot and travelers' materials which are brought to bear. And it's now, we're actually relatively fortunate because in the archives we can see the advice in terms of the letters that Laguz de la Boulaye actually gave him concerning how to set up the company, the terms of the company, the nature of the company, and so on. So in fact, at this moment, he transforms himself from the traveler and the savant and the ethnographer to a kind of a political actor who's actually giving advice concerning how the French should set up the company and in what way the company should be different from the two existing companies, which is to say the English company and the Dutch company. And interestingly, one of the arguments that Laguz de la Boulaye is prepared to make at this point is that one of the ways in which the French can distinguish themselves, he argues, is by presenting themselves very clearly as Catholic. That is to say, he argues that the Dutch and the English are not sufficiently assertive about their religious identity, whereas he argues that the French, in some sense, should be more assertive about their French French Catholic identity. And of course, this is something which is going to create tensions between him and the Huguenots like François Caron, who are involved in the company at the same time, who obviously don't share this view. But Laguz de la Boulaye eventually also is going to run into difficulties. Because of the fact that as he's writing and as he's presenting matters, the field is starting to get crowded. That is to say, there are more and more people who are writing, there are more and more people who are presenting matters, and presenting matters in ways that are competing with his vision of things. Bernier, I've already mentioned, who publishes his account about 10 years after Laguz de la Boulaye in the 1660s. But the person who actually has an enormous success, perhaps even greater in some respects than Bernier, is Jean-Baptiste Tavernier, who actually writes this account, or supposedly writes this account, because one suspects that it was, as I said, very largely written by somebody else at his behest. This account, which is the Six Voyages, which is much more attractive, which has much better quality of engravings, which is a much greater commercial success, probably as a consequence of this. But of course, Tavernier is also relentlessly competitive. He's someone who is quite financially interested in selling his travels. And one of the things which he does, therefore, is to systematically denigrate everybody else around him by claiming that they did not have the experiences they claimed they did, and so on. So a kind of a publishing war breaks out in a certain sense, which is carried out in part in this account by Bernier, but in particular in this account, which has one of the most really vicious attacks that one traveler has ever made on another in relation to this second part, which is the relation de ce qui s'est passé dans la négociation des députés qui ont été en Perse. This is the account which is where he talks about Laguz de la Boulaye. But this is the second voyage of Laguz de la Boulaye. Now Laguz arrives as the representative of the French East India Company in the 1660s. And it's in this incarnation that Bernier attacks him. He attacks him for speaking Persian badly. He attacks him for making a fool of himself in the Safavid court. He attacks him for being an alcoholic. He attacks him for being stingy. And eventually he describes the death of Laguz de la Boulaye in Patna, arguing that the reason why he was killed was because he was so stingy that he didn't want to pay for a ferry on his own, and he insisted on sharing it with some Iranian soldiers who killed him, therefore, on the ferry. Because they thought that he was carrying these chests which were full of money, but when they opened the chests, eventually it turned out that they were full of books and bottles of wine. So what we actually get then is this relentless attack on Laguz, which leads to a situation in which pretty much by the 1680s, he is reduced to a figure of fun. Of course, what Tavernier does to others is eventually done to Tavernier too. So we get, as the 17th century progresses, we get these competing views being put forward by people who are competing individuals, but also represent competing institutions. right? So we have, as I said, Tavernier and Bernier, who are presenting one view. Eventually you get Manucci, the Venetian, who represents still another view and who, for instance, has these very, very in turn rude remarks concerning Bernier and his lack of practical knowledge and his lack of real insight into India and Asia. However, what is actually discernible as this proceeds forward is the emergence of a kind of a generalization, which is not this generalization which Laguz de la Boulaye was actually interested in, which is the kind of formulation eventually of the generalization concerning the Oriental despot, right? Which is centered upon notions which Bernier is particularly interested in, which is the whole problem of the lack of stable property in the Orient, the fact of escheat being very important, the fact that eventually this is linked in some way, according to him, to Islamic law. And so what we eventually get then is the emergence of something which will be set in stone by the time we get to Montesquieu and beyond that. Even though, of course, the exception will remain well into the 18th century China, which is always treated somewhat differently from these areas. So what we then see is, to return to the question of Dew, what we see is a kind of a crystallization here of a kind of an institutional framework, a framework which is partly given to us by the company, which is partly given to us by the academies, which is partly given to us by royal patronage. But we see actually not one Orientalist or discourse concerning the Orient, but actually rather competing ones. We see also not a kind of a straightforward imposition of a view, but a much more complicated negotiation where both at the visual and perhaps even at the textual level, there are interventions of other people which are much more clear in the case of some accounts than in the case of others. And so eventually, in some senses, it's a question of these competing visions which have to resolve the tensions amongst themselves in the course of the second half of the 17th century. And to this extent, and to the extent that by the time you enter into the early 18th century, what we get is a sort of a resolution of this, we can say that it's here we have the birth of something which we can think of, not in the second sense, but in the first sense of Said as a kind of the preconditions of the emergence of a proper Orientalism. Now, it may be said, of course, that if you were to go back to the people in the Société Asiatique or to the people in the ZDMG, they might still not recognize in some of these authors their ancestors. And they might still not think of this, in some senses, as the birth of the disciplines in which they themselves participate. But I still think that one can make this argument, and I will leave you with, of course, the thought famously Arnaldo Momigliano put forward several decades ago, which is in some senses that what we have is at the heart of the emergence of many of these modern disciplines is the kind of creative combination of philology and oriental philology and antiquarianism. And in the spirit of someone like Laguz de la Boulaye, you can indeed see perhaps not so much of the philology, but certainly a certain amount of the antiquarianism, and to which I would add a third element, because surely in some of his binaries as well as in his triangulations, we should not be surprised to see not merely a precursor of the Orientalists, but perhaps even of Claude Lévi-Strauss. Thank you. I'm happy to take some remarks, questions. Yeah.
Thank you very much for this wonderful talk. This is very exciting material. It's very thought-provoking. Edward Said identifies amongst a branch of Orientalists, of the sort of interventionist Orientalists, identifies two streams within the one, at the risk of oversimplifying, one are the interventionists who want to modernize the Islamic world, and the other branch of these interventionists are the ones that want to sort of romanticize and preserve the Islamic world. Now that is late 18th, 19th century, the interventions. But just genealogically, is there any connection, or could you track Vulelu's as a precursor to either of those branches, or is he really, would you want to say he's sort of proto, he's before that kind of division?
I mean, you know, that division of Saeeds, you know, where it works very well is the other moment in which the term Orientalist is used, right? Which is something which he pays a little bit of attention to, perhaps, but not enough, which is many of those of you who have studied the history of British India will be aware of the fact that there was something called a debate which took place in, let's say, the 1820s or the 1830s between two groups who actually defined themselves and used the term as the Anglicists versus the Orientalists. Right? Now, that is actually the kind of binary that Saeed is talking about. Why? Because the Anglicists, who are best represented, let's say, by someone like Macaulay, would say, well, let's transform India by teaching the Indians English. Why? Because fundamentally what is written in Oriental languages is useless. The famous remark that, you know, there's more in a single shelf of any European language than there's in the entire writing in all Oriental languages put together. So let's get rid of this quote-unquote sort of Orientalist, or there's these Oriental languages, the Oriental culture, and modernize them in some senses by this transformation. And the Orientalists were those at that moment who actually were making the argument that, no, we need to actually preserve the Oriental culture, right? Which was a kind of a paternalist, still colonialism. So these are both colonial positions, but indeed which divide themselves precisely along those lines. But of course, both of these positions are predicated upon a certain notion of your capacity to actually either promote change or to impede it. Whereas what is actually very interesting over here is that none of these writers of the 17th century have any illusions whatsoever concerning their capacity to either produce or impede change. Right? So they're actually looking at a situation in which they see themselves as, and this is, you know, when Laguz Laboulaye writes this kind of memoir on what to do with regard to the East India Company, he's very clear. I mean, for instance, he says, that the Portuguese were completely wrong and they really didn't understand that you cannot push matters beyond a certain point. You know, that, he on the one hand, he doesn't want to take exactly the line of the English or the Dutch, but at the same time, he doesn't want to be in the situation of the Portuguese who imagine that they could intervene in a sort of decisive and massive way, which he doesn't think is actually at all sensible or feasible. Which is also interesting because, you know, if you sort of think about it, the whole long debate in the 16th century, which is something which people are coming back to again and again now, is, for instance, whether the European experience in America could be replicated in Asia. This is a very important debate in the 16th century, right? So, for example, could Cortes and Pizarro serve as models for how Europeans could act in Asia or not? Of course, periodically there were people who claimed that they could, right? I mean, especially the Spanish juntas operating out of Manila often claimed, 500 people and you can take China. But by this time, you're actually coming to a moment when the idea that the American experience can be replicated is gone. And in fact, it will have to be reinvented 50 years later in the middle of the 18th century when the moment of the conquest comes. And then there are many Europeans who don't actually understand that this can be done. Yeah.
I was very taken with the last slide that you put up.
Yes. Sorry, that was a bit of a self-advertisement.
I like the title very much, Three Ways to be Alien, and I assume that you modeled this on George Mikesh's book.
That's right.
Throughout that book. And one reveal to us about their views of Islam, because I somehow feel a void there in what I've learned so far.
Sorry, this is a different book. And then the aliens treated here are different from the ones I was talking about today, with the exception of Shirley, on whom I have a chapter in here. No, I mean, for example, let me just give you a sense of someone like Shirley, who again I think is a, refer to the more kind of picaresque and ruffianly side of him, but there's also a very interesting intellectual side of him. Because you see, Shirley, for instance, wrote a very interesting treatise which most people had never read or never bothered to take into account, which is with a very modest title of Peso Politico de Todo el Mundo, the political balance of the whole world, where he talks about the world as máquina del mundo, that the world is a machine, and there are these different bits and pieces that fit together. And then if you want to affect change, you can actually use pressure points, and you can push on this, and then this will produce that, and that will produce this, and so on and so forth. It's very interesting because the whole system is set up as where the key problem for him is Iran versus the Ottomans, Iran versus the Ottoman Empire. So this is a book where he's actually telling the Habsburgs in the 1620s that your strategy of the last 30 or 40 years has been to ally with the Safavids, right? Now, which is of course based, though he doesn't develop this point too explicitly, it's based on this misunderstanding on what Shiism is, right? Because there was a persistent misunderstanding in the 16th century that since the Safavids were 12 Shiis, therefore the 12 Imams were the 12 apostles, so therefore that Shiism was some kind of transformed version of Christianity, right? Which is also the view, there's also the view that Shah Ismail was really a Christian who converted or something. And actually what Shirley says is very interesting, where he says this is a completely mistaken idea, because we are under the notion today in the 1620s that the Ottomans are our enemies. This is completely wrong. Because if you actually look at the reality of things, the real problem for Spain is not the Ottomans, the real problem for Spain is the Netherlands. So he says if you want to deal with the Netherlands, you actually have to make peace with the Ottomans. And the fact that they're Muslims actually has nothing to do with it. It is not because they're Muslims that that you cannot make peace with them. The only thing is that to save yourself, your amour propre, you've got to make it appear that they proposed the peace. Right? But once you can actually manipulate that, make peace with them. And then he says, then the relationship between the Habsburgs and the Ottomans will be like the relationship between the sun and the moon. Right? And it's a remarkably curious, piece of, because of course, this is exactly the opposite of, let's say, the position of people like Botero and so on at roughly the same time, who are of course completely obsessed with the idea that, Islam is the problem. So, again, if you actually look at the whole sort of the traditions of this kind of political discourse of the late 16th and early 17th century, it is true that some people seem to think that really the fundamental thing to put your finger on is Islam, right? Which I think is indeed the case with Botero. It's the case with a certain number of religiously oriented, otherwise religiously oriented writers. But I think that what is interesting is, on the other hand, that a lot of my figures don't seem to think so. And certainly this is not the view of Laguz Labula. It's not the view of Shirley. And in fact, even Niccolo Manucci, whom I have over here at the end, the Venetian writing in India at the end of the 17th century, he actually says, Islam is not so bad. What is really bad is the Gentiles, the Hindus, whom he calls the Gentili. So for him, actually, that's the worst. The Muslims are actually, in some senses, much better and much closer. Though he's, of course, worried about this whole thing about, renegades and people passing from the one side to the other because of this relative proximity. He's worried about this. So, I think again, it's interesting how in the debates of the time, the problem of Islam is much more important to some people than to others, even in defining what an Oriental despot is. Yeah.
I enjoyed your lecture a lot. Thank you so much for coming here. I wanted to ask you a little bit about the Portuguese model and also about how French travelers related to Catholicism, two topics that, you mentioned.
Yes.
Now, I heard slightly contradictory statements. One, that the Portuguese were too assertive and therefore should not serve as a model, but the other one, that the French should be more Catholic, as it were, in their approach to foreign relations. And one of the things that
I mean, Catholic with a capital C.
Well, I don't know
yes.
what you mean by that.
Yes.
Because one of the things that strikes me is that the part of what the Portuguese model entailed was, in fact, in certain circles, certainly in canon law, was an assertion of a Catholic identity that involved, among other things, placing theoretical barriers on trade between Catholics and Muslims.
Yes.
Could you go, I know you know a lot about Portuguese trade, cross-cultural trade issues and so on, so I'm hoping you'll tell me how these travelers relate to these problems.
Yeah, you see, I mean, in some sense, the way I read at least Legouze Labelay, when he's writing his model, his memo of how, his memorandum of how this the French company should set itself out and so on, I think he's a bit worried about them not being, as a group, sufficiently careful about identifying themselves. So that's one of his worries, and that's where he thinks that their Catholic identity should actually serve as a marker, and they should actually make clear that this is what they are, right? But at the same time, I mean, he has this distinct sense that, you know, you cannot, that the idea of conquest, which for him the Portuguese had very, very clearly in their minds and which they constantly came back to, is not a viable proposition. You can't go there. Right? Now, so far as the Portuguese are concerned, I mean, remember that, I mean, this is the, you know, the whole Portuguese debate which, you know, runs through from João de Barros in the 16th century through to Serafim de Freitas in the 17th century, which is the whole question really of, you know, whether, as you say, canon law can be applied, what the rights are of non-Christian peoples, whether in fact, you know, one can even begin to imagine a kind of a literal implementation of those kinds of things in circumstances where, unlike in the New World, you're dealing with massive polities which are absolutely capable of repelling you and making mincemeat of you if it comes to that. What is the place of pragmatism in all of this? So these are actually debates which are constantly thrown around. I mean, there is a very, very interesting unpublished manuscript from about the 1580s where a bunch of theologians, of Portuguese and Spanish theologians, it's sort of like the Catholic equivalent of a fatwa collection or something like that, where they asked to give rulings on the legitimacy of certain practices. And they're actually real examples. So it says, you know, in 1566, so-and-so was in such and such a port, he had to do this. Do you think that this was actually okay or not okay? And you can actually see those debates playing themselves out, right? Where there are clearly the ones who, again, you know, there's a very interesting division even amongst the missionary orders on this question, right? And very often the Augustinians and the Dominicans will take a much harder line than the Jesuits. That's not a surprise, of course, right? And of course, you know, eventually this also, you know, as you know, it goes and it becomes a part of that larger discussion, which is even the so-called Indian rights and Chinese rights problems, which is to say, should you actually even present yourself clearly as different from them, or should you actually compromise even in your appearance? For instance, if they like it, why shouldn't I look like a Brahmin, even if I'm a Jesuit? If they want me to look like a Mandarin, I'm willing to look like a Mandarin. Right? Whereas in some sense, here I think there is an interesting paradox, because Legouze Labelay, when he was an individual traveler, was willing to call himself Ibrahim Beg and wear a turban and so on and so forth. But when it's now a question of the policy of a company, he doesn't want them to do that. He doesn't want them to show up You know, as Portuguese frequently did, and you know, there's a famous episode in 1521, the first official Portuguese embassy shows up in Bengal. When they show up there, they find that there are Portuguese who are already in Bengal and who are trying to convince the Sultan that there are two kinds of Portuguese, Christian Portuguese and Muslim Portuguese, and that they are Muslim Portuguese and therefore he should be trading with them. And this is the kind of problem which he clearly doesn't want to get into.
One last question, and then we can continue the conversation at the reception just outside this room to which you're all invited.
I was really fascinated by the inclusion of Indian artists in the manuscript version of this, and also just in general, I mean, their involvement in the construction of Western Orientalism. And I was wondering whether you can press a little bit harder on that.
Well, I have to confess that I have to spend considerably more time with the manuscript before I can actually entirely work out the relationship between these images and the text. I've only done relatively preliminary work so far with the manuscript, which is in Rome. But my impression is certainly that and again, it's curious because by the time you get to the printed version, something has happened because sometimes a gap has arisen. Sometimes an image which is not appropriate for a certain part of the text has been inserted for that part of the text. I gave you one example of that. But this never seems to happen in the manuscript version. He seems to have more or less clear control over the relationship between text and image. But it's actually also interesting because of the fact that as I said, this is now the manuscript dates to the 1640s. The printed version dates to the 1650s. You know, if you just take this back even, say, 50 years before, if you go to something like a famous text like Linz Houghton's Itinerario, which contains a whole bunch of very elaborate engravings, the vision of what he calls them, this Schreckliche Afgoden, he calls them, these horrible demigods, right? These frightening demigods, and they're monstrous, actually. Right? So basically, all these Hindu gods or whatever they are the only vocabulary he has for portraying them is these monstrous stereotypes, which come out of the late 15th, early 16th century, German engravings and so on and so forth. So this is what he has now. I mean, this is clearly a very, very different, visual vocabulary. I mean, these depictions of Krishna would be perfectly acceptable to be present. I mean, this is not high Mughal art, I agree with that. You know, this is not the kind of quality that a court artist would have. These are clearly people who are operating on a somewhat different scale. And there's always been this problem. I mean, I often suspect that these are very likely textile painters who were brought in to do this. Because actually, there was not an enormous popular tradition of paper painting. Painting on paper tended to be a courtly tradition at this point. Right? So, but it's perfectly acceptable. It's not at all monstrous. It's not at all meant to evoke that set of sentiments. Right? So I think that this is already an important kind of distinction by bringing these other people in. Now, of course, it's true that if you even read Said, I mean, he has very clear notions that, after all, that Orientalism is not simply a willed thing imposed by one group of people on the other. These kind of object populations also participate in some sense, right? But I mean, remember that the whole framing of Orientalism, as he himself says, is a Foucauldian framing, which appears at the very beginning. And there's an assumption about notions of power, the direction of power, and so on and so forth. And clearly, we can't directly apply it, and this comes back to your question, that, I mean, what someone like this imagines the meaning or the effect of his representations are, and what, say, someone like Macaulay imagines the effects are in the 1830s is very, very different. Right? I mean, this is, of course, everything is an intervention at one level, but it's a very different sort of intervention. And I think that is really quite crucial. And again, I think this is very interesting because if you were not in the Asia, but in America, then it, in the 1650s, it might have a quite distinct meaning. I mean, when you are actually getting, let's say, the Mexican codexes or whatever it is, there's a kind of negotiation and a relationship of power which is a very different one from this. I mean, what let's say Balbuena or someone is doing. Is very different from what someone like this is doing. I mean, this is not where you get a bunch of people and you stick them into a monastery and you say, you draw for me. Right? So, I mean, so we could do the two contrasts. We could do the chronological contrast and we could do the synchronic contrast with other situations in which Europeans are actually exercising a very different kind of power at the same time.
Yeah, they remind me a lot about the John White. For
Roanoke.
They get translated into the Grays, which create all sorts of changes in the process of that transformation. So just, but
yes,
not,
yes, but that was White who did it.
Not done by the
yes, 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 yes. Yes, but you see, because so it's White who does it, but then, and then White's whole convention of representation is a Western convention of representation. These are not, I mean, these are not typically perspectivized. You know, they you would never mistake this for a Western, for a European artist or French or Portuguese artist.
Yeah,
yeah.
We continued over food and drink. Thanks again for listening.